I don't want to wait too long because I have two presentations in 20-minute slots. Yeah. And actually, I can speak as long as I want to about these subjects. Let me start with inviting you to go to the Perlmonger meetings. In many cities in Europe and well everywhere in the world, you have meetings, regular meetings of Perlmongers, Perl addicts. For instance, Amsterdam PM meets every first Tuesday of the month, every month in Amsterdam, but it's more for the whole of Holland, because it's a small country. But nearly everywhere you have these groups, and then you have more time to talk about these subjects. Usually a 5-minute lightning talk on a conference takes us about 2 hours discussion at these meetings. So if you want to really learn how why people decide for developing code and so on, why they did it, how they can improve it and so on, come to these meetings. Well, let's get a start with this one. Translations. Who of you has ever done translations of code? Yeah, translations is a bit of a pain. Certainly if you have already existing code and you have to move towards translations. If you have existing code, then you have all kinds of usually formatting, formatting on web pages, formatting on emails, tables, prints, and so on. And the main work, most work, is by converting your print strings into something what is translatable. The first step you have to make is to go from just the interpolation of variables into something which is static, and then the variables are added in later. And now you can build a translation table based on this for to translate this English text into German and Dutch and so on. So that's the burden of having translations in your program. And it's horrible if you have to add it later, if you have already thousands of lines of print statements in your code. So how does it work? First, you have to reformat your print statements. Oh, yeah. And then the standard procedure is to call gettext. That's the GNU gettext library, where it looks up this string in the table. And then you get it back, the string back translated. And after that, the printf is adding the username in this string. You can do it better. So you get this this lookup, and with this that translation library comes a script. The script collects all the strings from your code and builds PO files, files which end on .po, and later you can even compile that into binary files called .mo files. And you have one per language, and this one is, for instance, in UTF-8 for the Dutch as spoken in the Netherlands. And then you have a domain name. That's because you have more translation tables for each of your programs. You have a different table. Yeah. Well, these are read by this getText function. These tables for the language which is selected, and then the translation is made. Okay. Well, these tables are format agnostic. They don't know that it will be used by printf. So you don't have to stick with printf, with just %s. You can just use other syntaxes. And many languages have libraries which do use named parameters instead of just these positional parameters, which makes it much more readable. And it's also easier for the translators to do it correctly, to understand what the lines mean. Well, let's make a little step aside. The step aside is that for about 10 years or so, I use a library. I developed a library, and I use it on all my larger CPAN modules. And I hope everyone will start using it, but still, it's not going very fast. My what I program day and night, and what I see is that all the time, three things what I do are very close related, I should say it. So. You know, I really like to write error messages. I really, so I think at least 30% of your code should be error handling. And I won't have error messages. The error messages must be logged somewhere, and maybe they must be translated as well. And you have an exception. So those three things, logging, exception handling, and translations, are really closely related. So why do we need three statements to do that in your code? Three statements, and then 10 lines below that. Again, the three statements to do the same. So I made a simplification, which has all three in it, and all three are optional. If you don't need translations, you still can use it. If you don't need exceptions, you still can use it. Yeah? I will show you how. So, for instance, this is a standard Perl. You get die. And well, what do we have? Print, warn, and die. That's all. Now, if you know about syslog or log for Perl or other logging frameworks, it's nice to have more levels, at least 8 or so different things, like a panic or a notice and so on, different log levels. So this is quite poor. So I took a few of these, I made a selection between all these different levels, what you have in frameworks. And for instance, you have an error, but you also have a fault. A fault, I make a distinguish between fault and error. A fault is an external problem where you usually have a dollar exclamation mark printed. Okay? So an operating system thing, what went wrong. An error is internal problem, you have mistake, you have a debug, you know, trace. So the things you expect in levels in other programming languages as well, and in syslog as well. And then, so instead of die, you use, in this case, fault. And you don't have to specify dollar exclamation mark, because faults are external causes, so they always have a dollar exclamation mark. And the other big step which I made was, I create an exception. Yes, it will be a die, but things like translations and interpolation of these variables, they are postponed as long as possible. They are postponed until the errors leave your program. And in your main program, in your main script, you'll say something like, well, okay, I want to dispatch all my errors to syslog. And what you can do is to have the same error messages in Chinese to the website, and at the same time with another dispatcher have it to in English to the log file, and so on. So you can also specify for this output a different level, for instance, to the log files in debug level, so everything and so on. So you can play with that, and this solves one of the main issues I always have with larger programs in Perl. There is no single logging framework in Perl. So if you use modules from different authors, then they all have their own way how to get the errors out. And what I can do is my framework accepts most of the error types, exception types from other modules, and converts that into a standard framework. And only on the top level, you tell them where the errors go to. So how does it work? This underscore x means translated. So here is the string which will get translated. This is, by the way, a normal function name. Just a normal function name. But not. I don't like these parentheses, but this is a normal function name. So, and this function captures the thing what must be translated. And this one is causing the exception. So the fault is creating an exception object. And the exception object of type fault contains a message which will be later translated. The message will have some parameters which will be filled in, but at the same time it collects, for instance, the table where my translations are in. And at the top of my program I write something like use log report, and then this file, this PM file, belongs to this domain, this text domain. So it's all quite lightweight. The only thing for translations what you need extra is underscore underscore x. Yeah? Okay, so you get a die with an exception object. And you might not know, but a die can have not only a string, but it can also have an object. So dollar at doesn't need to be a string, but it can also be an object. And in this case, if you try, it's also part of log reports. If you catch it, then you get an you can ask things like, did I die? It's also false if you died. You can also ask for the exception which was fatal. And you can also catch other things like trace information and so on in $@. But I want to have this fatal exception. And please print me that message in Dutch. Here it's very explicit. I want this string of the message translated into Dutch. But this whole interpolation can be used much more easily. It can be used in, it can be more generic. The whole interpolation, why is there not a CPAM module which is doing smart interpolation to replace printf? Well, actually there are at least 10 of CPAM modules which can replace the printf. So string print is my version. It contains a printe, print interpolated, and then it the two string will cause a translate. The message ID is the string, and then some extra parameters which have to be filled in. So message interpolated, print I gets the parameters and the translated version of the string. I hope it's not going too fast for you. Okay, there's also a print P in the same module, and now you have this positional printing. And the nice thing about positional printing is that you can say things like this: at most 20 characters I want to be inserted here. And we lost that in this curly syntax. So I added that to the curly syntax. Now you can say, hey, I want to have it filled in, but also a maximum 20 characters inserted. Oh, I thought, but this is a kind of modifier of the variable to be filled in. I can also say, I want to have as modifier, not a percent something, but a modifier, pounds. And now, the modifier, you can define the modifier somewhere, and you can say, okay, my prices are, for instance, in euro cents, but in this case, I want to have them displayed in pounds. And even you can add defaults. If you're used to translations, you will see that you may remember that it's quite hard sometimes to get exceptions in the print. So I do not have a value for this. And if you, then you may need to have two or three translation strings translated separately. Well, you can translate this in one. So I want this in English. I want to have the price in pounds and the text sold out if there's nothing, and in Dutch I want to have it in euros and uitverkocht if it is if I don't have nothing a price for it, if it is undefined. Okay, now template toolkit, nearly to the end because that was the talk. I brought this translation framework to template toolkit and made some simplifications. This is how template toolkit usually works. Who uses template toolkit? Yeah, so this is the name of the file, the template, and you have some parameters to be filled in, and these are configurations for a template toolkit. Well, if you want to use this translation framework with template toolkits, you need this, a text domain, the domain name, a function name, which is used in the templates for translation, a directory where your translation tables are, and this is a function you have to call every once in a while to extract translatable strings from your template, from templates. This is all you need to add. And what do you get? Well, you can usually you can call functions, for instance, or variables from your parameters filling in, and you say, okay, this is a Perl variable, so I have to translate it into HTML, forced into HTML. The log function which we defined before, it will automatically produce HTML. So the translation tables are just in UTF-8, but it will be entity encoded. You don't have to do it yourself anymore. Things like this. This is a typical way of template toolkit variables. No dollar sign in front of it. If you already produce HTML, then you just label your the variables you fill in with underscore HTML. You can configure that if you want to. So this will not get double encoded. Otherwise, it gets. But the nice thing is with the modifiers, I can also have a dot modifier. And so this is the default for this template toolkit extension. Now I can just add it in here. I want from the user, here I specify the user object, it's probably a hash. And the full field of that hash must be inserted in there. Makes it simpler. Less code, less typing. You can even do this. Because the nice thing is, in Template Toolkit, I can look into the namespace. I can see which variables were passed in. So I can look up user. It's impossible in a Perl program. In a Perl program, you just have to insert variables with dollar name, and they must be known at compile time. But here, I can do it in runtime. So it's not much more work to print a string than you already had. And now you get translations with it, only at lock. And all the features I showed you with the percent and so on and defaults are in here. Something like this. The price, well, the product is passed as variable. And it has a price field or a price method or a price. And there are many ways the template toolkit supports this. This could be price, could be even a code reference within the product hash, and it will automatically be called. That's how template toolkit works. It also works with this translation. So little extra code, and you get this call to lock. You can even use different namespaces in the same program and the same translation set, but then you have to use different function names. So that was my first. How much time do I have?
2 minutes.
Okay, so it was a bit fast. If you want to know more, come to our meetings. Yeah, come to our Monger meetings. Questions? Yeah.
Is there extensive documentation available with a few workflow examples?
With a few workflow examples? No, there are examples. There's documentation, in, as usual, in the manual pages.
Yeah.
And I know the author, if you write him a message, if you don't understand it, he will help you. He always does. But nearly everything you need is already in here.
Okay.
You just specify a directory where your files are, and you run this extract every once in a while, and it works. I didn't explain how you make translations.
Yeah.
That's more work to set up Puttl or something like that for translations. Yeah.
Have you investigated how this could be integrated with JTemplate, which is template toolkit in JavaScript, so you can have the template toolkit functionality on the client side?
I don't think so.
Yeah.
I don't want to go in that direction. The translation tables can be very large, so I don't want to send them over. Well, that could work, but more questions? I have only twice 20 minutes, so I have another talk for you.